ask your question live directly following the next presentation. We have JP Carvallo from Berkeley Lab. He's going to talk to us about integrating the tools that we have for distribution and bulk power system planning in order to do a more comprehensive approach. JP?
All right. Thanks. Thanks, Lisa. Thanks, everyone, for attending and for the invite to present here. I'm going to speak about, as Lisa mentioned, modeling tool frameworks or modeling frameworks to integrate tools, some of them existing, some of them novel, to get at whole systems types of analysis for electricity planning. So in terms of content, I'm going to give a brief overview of distributed resource, you know, trends and how these trends trigger some regulatory policy and modeling needs. We're going to spend the bulk of this presentation talking about power system planning. I'm going to lay out the traditional modeling frameworks that exist, just so we're all in the same page. And in part because some of the novel integrative frameworks that I'm going to share leverage some of these models. I'm going to introduce in more detail two types of comprehensive or integrative modeling approaches called sequential integrated modeling and comprehensive integrated modeling. The first one, SIM, will be the subject of a much more in-depth training on October 20th that you are also invited to attend. So I'm going to be giving some very brief results and sort of show the characteristics, but we are going to delve into that much more later. We're going to spend a little bit talking about what happens beyond the power system, sort of integrating beyond the electric system into the energy system, and just to give a sense of what kinds of tools are out there. And then we'll have some questions and resources and contact information. So this is probably you're all aware of the distributed resources adoption or deployment has increased substantially over the past decade among many states. And the resources offers a host of benefits. And those benefits ripple up to not only in the distribution system, but are ripple up to the transmission and generation domains. But these benefits are rarely captured simultaneously. The types of analysis that we conduct to capture our benefits usually are limited to a single domain, most typically the distribution system, as Juliet and Tom presented recently, but the impact of the ER, especially in higher levels of adoption, do encompass the whole system. At the same time, these distributed resources can impose technical and economic constraints and costs of the system, which are also important to capture. And again, it rarely happens that they're captured simultaneously. And so the lack of integration in analysis of the ER impacts may miss capturing the full value of the ER and both you know, the benefits and the cost, and may also hinder proper assessments for non-wires alternative implementations that are typically developed using metrics or rules of thumb or values that are coming from different types of studies that are not internally consistent. So I'm going to stop here for 1 second and move into a poll just to keep us engaged. And this is more like a trivia kind of poll. So let's see about your knowledge of distributed solar in the US. How much distributed solar PV had been installed in the US by July of this year, according to the US Energy Information Administration? You have 5 options there. Let's see, how much are you tracking adoption of solar PV in this country? I'll give you 10 more seconds to answer, and we're gonna see. All right. Oop, there you go. Look at that, very close. The correct answer is 31 gigawatts. It's 30.7, more precisely. So quarter of you got it right, and many of you were very close. So that's great. All right, let's keep moving forward now. I'm gonna go into how does the ER trend start driving some regulatory and policy planning needs. And again, a single slide that essentially is restating that, of course, with this amount of distributed resources, it's getting it's intrinsically important to capture the full stack of benefits that these resources bring to the system. It's also becoming important to understand the trade-offs between or the cost-effective combinations of distributed and digital scale resources. You know, up to recently, the scale of distributed resource adoption was relatively small. Most utilities were dealing with that as a negative load of sorts. And just subtracting it from the load forecast. But at this point, and what's looking into all these forward-looking studies that are studying decarbonization trends, is that we're going to, there is a potential for extensive and massive adoption of distributed resources. And that starts opening policy questions around the trade-offs between installing these distributed resources and utility scale resources. So this not only comes from a cost perspective, but also comes from a resilience perspective. And so it's important in pondering these questions, it's important to have models that can help target policies, that can help design policies that can drive resource deployment, both at the utility, but also the distributed scale in the desired directions. And that's where these comprehensive whole systems kind of tools come in. As we move forward with analyzing distributed resources, particularly distributed resources that are of a renewable nature, like solar PV fundamentally. There are spatial and temporal aspects, resolution aspects that become increasingly important. Spatially, as Juliet and Tom showed very clearly, the distribution system is massive and is vast, and DERs are typically deployed deep into the distribution system. So to understand the impacts of the are clearly there, the models have to have enough spatial resolution to be able to identify almost at the customer level, or at least at the transformer level in the distribution system, what's going on. It's important to be able to represent resource diversity. So if you aggregate spatial geographic zones, you're losing substantial resource diversity that comes up even within smaller zones, can come up due to shading, due to particular intra-urban radiation or other patterns. And this is also important for distributed wind that can have very diverging patterns of production even within smaller areas. And finally, transmission and distribution expansion require, almost by definition, since they're gridded systems, enough spatial resolution to represent the nodes and substations that are involved in those decisions. Temporally, it has been evident for some time that when you're studying investment and operation, those are just two very different time frameworks. We study investment in the years to decades, and we want to understand operation in the daily to hourly fashion. So we need frameworks and models that are able to capture these two. And I'm going to delve into this a little bit more in a couple of next slides. And finally, there's the question of the objecting function. Traditionally, since least cost modeling emerged in the 70s and transitioned into integrated resource planning in the 80s, there's been a single objective function: reduce the cost for the system, which typically means reduce the cost for the utility. Over time, we have been adding elements to this objective function that try to encompass larger societal objectives, one of which, for example, is carbon costs. So as we add carbon costs and we include or try to reflect the social cost of carbon in these exercises, we're starting to think move beyond the utility cost into social cost. But this leaves open questions of, who is this being optimized for? Are we optimizing for the customers, for the utility? Are we trying to optimize for everyone, or a societal optimization? Or should all these be contained in the same model or different models? So all these are outstanding questions that models have to be able, at least flexible enough, to address. Let's move on now into power system planning. And I'm going to spend a couple slides referring to planning processes very generally. Traditionally, power system planners have drawn a hard line, that red line that you see right there in between generation and transmission and the distribution and sort of consumption side of things. And for decades, this has been the way transmission planning has been held. The generation and transmission side of things has been either handled by in vertical integrated utilities through some sort of resource planning process, either integrated resource planning or a least cost planning process. And in restrictor states, this has been passed in part to RTOs and ISOs. And the distribution side of things has remained largely on the distribution utility. There are, between generation, transmission, and distribution and consumption, there have been progress in integrating those planning aspects. Juliet and Tom spoke quite extensively about the distribution planning and how it's been beginning to be linked with demand-side management planning, essentially trying to think about the ERs and distribution planning in a single framework. On the other side of generation and transmission have been generally been linked in different ways, even in the cases of RTOs that are supposed to plan for transmission, they have to incorporate assumptions about generation expansion for their regional analysis. So there are some interfaces happening between these, but yet we don't have a full view of, you know, these four domains integrated at the same time. And that's where, what I'm going to delve into in the core of this presentation. Finally, a quick note on language that I wanted to bring up here, since I talked already about integrated resource planning or IRP. You know, the language will get us here. I didn't want to use integrated to refer to this kind of whole system analysis, because integrated has been already borrowed by IRP and is already borrowed by integrated distribution planning to talk about the two domains here to the right. So I'm going to use integrative as a way of referring to these whole systems kinds of analysis. And I'm using comprehensive to refer to a specific type of whole systems analysis that I'll expand on later, as opposed to sequential. And so I just wanted you to have that in mind in terms of having the language clear, at least for this presentation. These are by no means agreed upon types of terms, with the exception of integrated. I think we're developing, this is a very nascent effort, and we're developing the language, appropriate language, to refer to these types of models and frameworks. It's important to note when we talk about planning, that there are really two main decisions that are being taken in power system. Investment is what you link more immediately with planning, but it's becoming increasingly evident that we have to think about operation while we are making investment decisions. And this is because in one hand, because variable renewable resources are by their very nature more uncertain in their production, and that means that that from a resource adequacy perspective, investment has to be taken into account that uncertainty in some way. And in addition, because in many restructured markets, is the operation that it's what defines marginal costs and essentially defines many of the financial aspects of the system that later make investment decisions pan out or not. So there is definitely a link there. It's important, as I mentioned, to make sure that the investment outcome is operationally realistic. And so that has led to many modeling frameworks and researchers attempting to link investment and operation in different ways. And here to the right in this diagram that I borrowed from a really good paper by some Enrel folks and others, they lay out four levels of that type of integration, where you can have investment or operational models separated and then subsequently stronger links until you get to a level of full co-optimization. And the types of models that we're going to talk today, they're doing co-optimization at the domain level, and they're also doing co-optimization at the investment and operation level. And in some cases, trading off that co-optimization for some level three here, sequential type of optimization, just to make the modeling tractable. I'm going to go and spend some time getting us all on the same page in terms of the types of model that exist. As I mentioned earlier, this is useful because one of the two types of innovative modeling approaches that I'll present, sequential integrative modeling, does employ these kinds of models in its inception. So from in the bulk power system, and the capacity expansion side, we're talking about types of models that can answer the question, what is the least cost out of resources to meet prescribed load and a host of other types of constraints. And you have seen probably many of these models used in integrated resource planning processes or regional planning processes by ISOs and RTOs, Plexus Aurora, the RPM and REITs models by NREL, system optimizer and strategies, which are two just industry standard tools as like Plexus, and even some academic models like the switch model that I'm very familiar with. Pretty much every research group and lab in, that works in modeling will have some sort of capacity expansion tool developed. At the production cost level, in the next bullet, we're concerned about what is the least cost dispatch. What is the way to manage generation and transmission resources to achieve the lowest operational cost possible during a certain smaller time frame? And these are types of models that are commonly used, even in some cases, to prescribe dispatch decisions in coordinated settings. Tools like Plexus, Promo, GE Maps, and GridView come to mind. So these tools have investment set, and they're just using the existing assets and looking for ways to dispatch them, and also represent some of the more realistic aspects of dispatch, including unit commitment, to get closer to the reality of operation. And in terms of realism, the last set of models is really the reliability models or power flow physical models that are trying to describe the physics of a grid and usually they focus on very, very short periods of time to understand what could go wrong from a reliability perspective with certain characteristics of the system. Some typical examples are Dixieland, Powerwall, and PSSE from Siemens. At the distribution level, Julian and Tom talk quite extensively about these kinds of models. I'll just say, using sort of the same structure from the capacity expansion, there are really very few models that can make distribution planning expansion decisions fully automatically. One of them is a reference network model developed by Universidad Comillas and also taken up by the MIT quite extensively. They have used this model both in some regulatory settings that require a reference kind of network. It requires rebuilding the distribution system network to offer a benchmark to the actual distribution company that it's being regulated and whose rates are being set. And this model is also being used extensively in electricity access applications in Africa and Asia particularly. From the production cost perspective, there's not really, that doesn't quite apply to distribution so far. Distribution systems are not operating on a daily basis focused on cost. They're much more focused on reliability. But as the ER penetration keeps going up, there may be a space where distribution system operators may begin to operate their distribution systems, focus on costs and managing the different assets that will exist within the distribution system network. So far, this is not a specific focus. And then the powerful models are, again, powerful models that are representing the reality, the physical reality, the flows, voltage level losses, and loading levels of a distribution system. These are models that are intimately linked to planning. These are the models that provide that nowadays provide information for distribution system planners to make decisions of investment, usually in a manual or sort of rules of thumb heuristic kind of basis. And these models were also covered by Tom and Yulek recently. Finally, in the demand side management side of things, there are a host of different models that are doing a lot of different things. There's not very much planning per se going on this side. So I'll just pick up a few models that are really focused on assessing customer benefits or trying to define or size distributed resources to achieve certain objectives, usually either to minimize a bill or to maximize a certain type of value. We do know that Julia and Tom talk about some of these models are being now used in a non-wireless alternative setting to maximize the benefit for the system. Some of this model includes DURCAM by LBNL, REOP by NREL, and the storage fed and DERVET suits by EPRI. So now let's move from this domain level analysis. At this point, I hope I set you up with a pretty good knowledge of the three domains in generation, transmission, and distribution, or four domains, including the customer, the demand side, and the types of tools that exist there. And now there's, as I mentioned earlier, there is this need to understand the impacts of DER across all these domains. And since their impacts of distributed resources are typically constrained to one domain, We need kinds of tools that are able to, or frameworks that are able to do this process that are different from the ones that are already presented. So as I mentioned, there are two types of modeling approaches that are nascent and that I want to share with you and give some examples for. The comprehensive integrated modeling, CIM, unfortunately, same acronym as the common information model that Tom shared earlier. We can definitely work on that. But for now, let's stick with this for this presentation for the CIM model. This is a single optimal decision-making framework that encompasses decisions in investment and operation in generation, transmission, distribution, and distributed resources. You can already sense that this is it's kind of a massive model. It has a lot of benefits and a fair amount of limitations. I'll delve into those in a little bit. And then sequential integrated modeling, this is a staged decision-making framework where each domain is still simulated individually, but there is a consistent internal consistency across the way these models are linked in such a way that the results are all internally consistent and can reflect whole systems impacts of distributed resources. And the main benefit is that this sequential integrated modeling uses industry standard tools. So from a legitimacy perspective, it's really a framework to integrate existing tools rather than a tool itself. From sequential integrated modeling, the framework is a very coarse way in which the framework is laid out. As I mentioned, we will delve into this much more detail on October 20th, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. But essentially, the idea is that we, in this kind of framework, there are adoption and operational profile scenarios that are developed with native load forecasts. And this provides a net load that is fed simultaneously to a distribution analysis through power flows and manual or automatic upgrades and a capacity expansion production cost model. And so they're aggregated to fit into the bulk power system, and they're also fit in the distribution system. And so these results can be joined together to get and understand the technical, economic, and even the rate impacts. I'm going to provide two examples. This is a recent work that we at LBNL did for the state of Indiana in the context of the 21st Century Energy Policy Task Force. And so this work was developed for the Indiana Utility Regulatory Commission. And what you're seeing here to the right is a diagram that explains in a little bit more detail how we implemented this sequential integrated framework in this particular case. Perhaps a couple of things that I will highlight is to the left that there were we developed three adoption levels, individual adoption levels for PV and for electric vehicles and for battery storage, based on existing documents and other documents from different states, and then we combined these three adoption levels to produce a set of scenarios for adoption, six different scenarios for adoption that combine levels of adoptions of these resources in different ways. So that allowed us to explore a wide range of potential futures. And on the right-hand side, we took a specific approach for distribution system analysis, where we spent time on collecting information from feeders and conducting statistical analysis to identify representative feeders. And this is an effort that has been going on for about 15 years now in different spaces, actually started by PNNL, in the mid-2000s, and it's a very promising approach that allows to represent with high fidelity distribution system feeders and do analysis on them, and then scale these results up to represent larger portions of the geography. So without the need to represent thousands of feeders on a single process. In this case, in the Indiana example, there were about 3,000 feeders collected, and we were able to reflect these feeders in six representative types of feeders. A dense urban, a rural overhead, a mixed urban or mixed semi-urban feeder with a certain amount of underground. And so these feeders were really representing different types of grids and different types of impacts of DERs. And so this was all analyzed using the SIMDIS, the SIME power floor system, and at the same time, aggregated at the bulk power system level and analyzed with Plexus on Aurora to arrive to some conclusions. And I'm going to share a couple of the results so you can get a sense of the types of analysis that we were able to conduct. On the distribution side, as I mentioned, we had explicit feeders, real feeders that were equipped. In this case, all these this feeder diagram that you see here, all the red dots are nodes, are consumption nodes, and all the yellow dots are PV nodes. So we develop a whole methodology to allocate PV in certain nodes based on consumption levels by users, because we had customer level information for each one of these feeders. And so we were able to produce a pretty realistic adoption pattern spatially, and that allowed us to run analysis and then take some measures to correct potential voltage drop or line loading issues, and therefore translate these into costs. At the same time, we aggregated across the six feeders, we scaled up for each scenario these results and passed this 8760 vector of dispatch at the power core system level, run it on capacity expansion and production cost models, and we're able to capture then the generation and transmission level impacts and translate those from technical to cost impacts, and then summarize everything in this chart that you're seeing here. So just sort of what's showing here is the 2 years of analysis, 2025 and 2040, and the five types of scenarios. I'm not going to delve into detail on what they are, but you can see that in some scenarios have, for example, negative costs relative to a business as usual case. And the boundary scenario, which is an extreme high adoption sort of scenario, has very high or relatively high impacts on generation and transmission, much lower in distribution. So this showed to the regulator that distribution systems were pretty, had enough space and capacity to absorb most of the DERs, but particularly unmanaged electric vehicles could trigger peak demand levels that would trigger in ripple up to the transmission and generation level. And so it's a strong signal for them, for example, to start looking at managed charging for EVs because of their impacts at the bulk power system level and not so much at the distribution level. A recent study published by NREL is the second example of that I'm going to bring up for sequential integrative modeling. The LA100 study, some of you may have seen it. And the LA100 study was an effort between NREL, the Los Angeles Department of Water, Department of Water and Power, and the city of Los Angeles to look at futures, fully decarbonized future or mostly decarbonized future for the area. And NREL, of course, didn't know that because this sequential integrated modeling framework is not fully adopted, but they actually developed exactly this a very similar process that the one that I just showed for Indiana with a range of other with some expanded analysis. But in first, the way they lay out the study, they work on three levels. At the customer level, they work on demand projections and DER adoption, which is the exact same step that the first step that happens in sequential integrated modeling. In the second level, they analyze the renewable energy investment and operations, so the capacity expansion of the bulk power system, and then the distribution system analysis impacts the exact same sort of analysis that we take into consideration for sequential modeling. And then they added a layer of community level or social and extra power system impacts that could be added in sequential modeling if needed, but they go outside a power system. And this sort of complex diagram to the right, and I'm gonna not make you follow all the little lines, but this shows how they integrated their tools in the same way that a sequential integrated modeling would do. They took their forecasting models for demand and distributed resource adoption and plugged them into distribution analysis. And then they took the aggregates of those same plus the utility scale and plug them into the capacity expansion model, and then verified resource adequacy and power flows for reliability purposes and feedback that, and then brought together distribution and capacity expansion into a single sort of impacts framework. So in many ways, very similar. What things they did different, of course, the approach for distribution system analysis was more like a census. This particular study studied about 80% of the feeders of LADWP, which were several thousands of them, and they analyzed these through automatized frameworks, just like we did in Indiana, but they did it for many, many scenarios and many feeders. So this particular study ended doing millions of simulations And for developer system, they used similar types of tools that they were using on the Indiana work. In this case, RPM, the resource planning model developed by Enroll, which is a capacity expansion model, and then Plexus, an industry standard to verify production costs and verify reliability aspects as well. And their outcomes are interesting in that they include, as expected, they include both utility scale and distributed resources. In this case, the levels of utility resource resource adoption do obey much more the outcomes of the forecasting models rather than a whole systems decision model. So essentially, each one of these scenarios has a differing amount of distributed resource adoption that depends on the types of scenarios and assumptions that are being built in, and not so much depend on interactions between utility scale and distributed resources from a cost perspective. Although, given that this is a sequential modeling approach, the utility scale resources are, of course, consistent with the decisions that happen at the distributed level. In some of the results, it's important to highlight that they rely on a fair amount of hydrogen, combustion turbines, and fuel cells in some scenarios. And so the technology readiness levels of those technologies are still incipient. But there are, of course, this is a 2045 analysis. So there is still plenty of time for the technology development to catch up and these results to be applicable. Now, there is a need to go from sequential integrated modeling to comprehensive integrated modeling. And the main reason is that the sequential modeling approaches DER investment and operation as completely external to the model or exogenous. So they're not influenced by decisions, investment decisions or operation decisions happening in other parts of the system. Now, this is relatively true in the short and medium term. And it has been certainly true in the way distributed resources have been deployed around the world, where there have been mostly customer-made decisions when they're customer-owned. And even if they're utility-owned, they're still generally not obeying to a whole systems analysis, much more to a non-wireless alternative distribution system local analysis. However, in the long term, across a decade or two, the impacts of DER adoption as they ripple up may translate to changes in retail levels, or potentially changes in the design of those retail of those retail rates, and that could affect back in some way distributed resource adoption. And this already has been showing up in some of these calls and actually policies implemented for capacity payments from distributed resources to compensate some of the ways they use the grid. At the same time, DER adoption does trigger distribution system causing capacity constraints, and that could entail, in turn, keep driving upstream investments in utility or utility investment that can affect rates. So all this is to say that the full cost of benefits of DER may only be captured when these optimal decisions are taken simultaneously. And so this is the kind of model that I'm going to introduce. Now, these models, I will warn right away, are much less developed, are much more nascent. They're certainly not industry standards yet. And so this is an opportunity to start thinking about what these models bring and how could potentially evolve into tools that can be used not only by regulators or state energy officers, but more broadly by utilities and other stakeholders. So in the comprehensive integrated modeling framework, the only input is a native load forecast and some characterization of the existing distribution and bulk power systems. But all the decisions of investment and operation across the three domains are happening within a single framework. This is essentially like a centralized social planner of sorts. And while this centralized social planner does not readily apply to the types of industrial organization that we have in the way we operate systems, we have, of course, divisions, and we have disintegration within domains, and in many cases, the customers are the ones making adoption decisions at the distributed resource level, and not a central planner. These results can guide policy development and design to go in certain directions that are deemed more optimal. I'm going to bring up two models here. The first is the grid access and planning model, the GAP model, that I'm familiar with because I developed it for my dissertation, so full disclosure. This is mostly an academic model. It's one of the few CIMs that exist. And so I'm going to provide to you some of the ways this model has been used in a couple of different settings, both in a mature system, but also I'm going to share a couple of the model applications in an electricity access system to give you a sense of its features. In terms of the distribution system, the GAP model uses the same idea of drastically reducing the extent of the distribution system by representing it by using representative feeders rather than the whole population of feeders for a given region. Now, in contrast of the SIM kind of model, this GAP model is a single capacity expansion model that makes all these decisions that are laid out here at the same time. Investment in supply side resources, including many options for variable renewable energy and non-variable renewable energy and storage. The variable costs of these supply side resources are taken into consideration. The investment in or capital costs in transmission lines, substations, primary distribution lines and transformers, although it doesn't consider the secondary distribution system, and investment and operation of distributed resources, in this particular implementation, PV storage and diesel. This GAP model can be operated, it was designed to be this centralized big social planning model, but we designed also a version that can detach the customer decision in a decentralized mode. And so these customers are making decisions first on their DER investments based on their own utility minimization sort of framework. And then the rest of the power system, the distribution, transmission, and generation, are following those and making their own at least cost decisions to meet the outcomes of this. And so in some ways that reflects a little bit better than what's currently the setup in most power systems, and it still allows to capture whole systems analysis when needed. So this is an example of result example of a recent paper where this model was applied to a utility in Northern California. I will say that we didn't have access to some key information that was not publicly available for the utility. So there are several assumptions here in terms of the results, but the main results are still hold very interestingly. So to the left in this panel, you see the centralized results. So the model making all the decisions jointly and at the same time. And this particular centralized result has very little distributed resource adoption, has only some DER storage being adopted in every year, but it has very little distributed solar PV. And that's in part because the PV that this model or that the model is using is utility scale PV that's used to meet RPS targets. And to the right here, you see six different decentralized, well, eight different decentralized or frameworks in which customers are making their own decisions based on rates with and without net metering and rates of different types. So to the left, you have flat volumetric rates, and these types of rates trigger much higher adoption of distributed solar, especially in the case when there is net metering. And when there's no net metering, there is a higher adoption of distributed storage, because distributed storage allows for the customer to get the most value out of the distributed PV. And these all come, as you see here in the negative side of this panel, these all come at the expense of trade-offs with utility scale solar and wind. Of course, once customers are meeting their own needs with these resources, there's less adoption, and the adoption comes not at the cost of natural gas or hydro, because those are already pre-existing, but mostly because from new wind and solar. And to the right, we have the two top right two facets or panels analyze a time of use rate and a rate where we pass the customer the short-term marginal cost. This is the customer is really a real-time pricing rate. And those rates mimic much closer what the centralized planner would decisions would be. So this is an interesting result that tends to support the idea that as we approximate rates towards marginal costs or real-time pricing rates, that could reflect better the value that resources bring to the system and make decisions that are more aligned with this comprehensive planning system. Now, again, I wouldn't take these results as rules of thumb. There's a lot of work that has to be done here in terms of refining assumptions, but this is an indication of what these kinds of models can do. In the same vein, I want to quickly show an example of an analysis done for Africa. This is an analysis done for Kenya with the same model, where the question was, what is the kind of way to supply customers? Should we supply customers only with a grid, like we do in most mature systems, you know, up to 20 years ago? Or should we intentionally deploy a mix of distributed resources and grid? And so in these two panels that you see here with results, the left-hand side panel doesn't have DERs available, and the right-hand side panel has the renewable DERs available. And in dense urban areas, the preferred mode of supply, you can see in that sort of pink block is grid and storage, is a distribution system grid reaching all the customers, and storage to be able to capture and dispatch to meet local peak demand levels. And as the systems get more sparse and losses start being more and more important, the model tends to suggest off-grid types of solutions where all the ERs are employed, namely diesel, solar, and storage, and to supply locally not only at the customer level, but also within small microgrids that are created at the distribution level. And this is, for example, an example of how the distribution capacity expansion decisions happening in the system. You see here three investment periods and how the distribution system, considering subject to budget constraints, expands progressively over time and creates small microgrids and integrates distributed resources back into the system. And so these two results offer some ways in which you can think, in which policymakers in mature system can think more broadly about how should customers be supplied in terms of grid and distributed resource balances, and more broadly, and then how, what this means for the rest of the system as we use grid and we need, you know, supply side resources to be able to to use the grid effectively. And the same with this particular model, this kinds of approach can help make decisions about repowering and upgrading existing distribution systems, or whether, you know, it's kind of an alternative, non-wires alternative type of approach. A second example that I will briefly mention is the WISDOM model developed by Bavarian Clean Energy. This is also a very nascent model, mostly used by nonprofits. And in some cases, this model has been used in the capacity expansion and production cost versions only by some utilities, but their fully integrative CIM approach has only been used by nonprofits. And this is a model that's characterized by very high temporal and spatial resolution weather data that provides very, very high fidelity representation of variable renewable resources. It does co-optimize back power system expansion and dispatch, and it has the option to represent distributed resource adoption, bring it all the way up to the transmission system without really taking into account the direct distribution system impacts or power flows, but it does take into account the impacts of those aggregate distributed resources in the rest of the system. So in that way, it's closer to a comprehensive model, even though it's not fully assessing the expansion costs at the distribution system level. It is able, given this trade-off, to represent the whole US, which is quite unique. The gap model is much more geared towards a regional representation. And so one, for example, result recently that came from this WISDOM analysis done for California was that they compared what would happen if the model was run without the option to deploy distributed resources, and then with the option to deploy local solar, as they called it. And of course, in this case, the model deployed a relatively high amount of rooftop community and distributed solar when it was available and produced substantial savings. Now, interestingly, these results are opposite to what the GAP model was showing with this for this Northern California utility. And this underscores the need to that these tools are nascent, and there is still a fair amount of work to make these tools comparable, and to make sure the assumptions and the basic modeling frameworks that are used are also comparable to each other. There are shared challenges of sequential and comprehensive integrated modeling. Both are very data intensive. And so this starts getting at what kinds of data are needed. You don't only need to characterize the generation and transmission, you know, infrastructure, but you also need a fair amount of information on the distribution system. Either if you use representative feeders, because you still have to sort of identify those representative feeders using information for all the feeders in a system, or even if you're simulating them like LA100, which spends a fair amount of time curating and the feeder models that were given to them and making sure they were internally consistent and they could run in the simulation platforms that they had. So they will definitely need cooperation from distribution utilities to get access to not only the infrastructure data, but also the customer level information that's needed to do a proper allocation of distributed resources within feeders spatially and also over time in terms of adoption. And as I mentioned already, the computational tractability or requirements of these models can be quite onerous. The Indiana study conducted about 4,000 simulations only for the distribution system. The LA100 study conducted millions of simulations. And for example, the GAB model, the CIM model, can take up to 16 hours for a single run and eventually up to 2 days, depending on the type of implementation. So very briefly, going away from the power system, we have covered extensively the power system. There are some models that can help make decisions across the energy sector. And so analyze trade-offs between using other types of fuels or energy carriers for either space heating, cooking, transportation, all industrial processes, and particularly important now for hydrogen and the power system. And so some of these models are, for example, the NEMS models by EAA, used in the annual energy outlook, which is more like a macroeconomic model with some technical elements attached. The TIMES model is a similar model used in Europe. These models are trading off fidelity in the power system to be able to represent the whole system. And then the NARM model by DOE is a reliability and resilience model that's looking to identify resilience strategies across different energy systems, assuming and incorporating these substitutions. So I wanted to point out that these models are out there. In general, the main challenge is that most of these decisions lie outside of the purview of regulators, but they are within state energy officers in terms of at least trying to make these quite diverging sectors start to connect and talk to each other. So I just have a few questions here. I'm not going to read them individually. Questions that you could ask in terms of how analysis are being conducted and what would be the benefits of these comprehensive and sequential integrative modeling frameworks. And I've laid out a couple of slides with resources. These are resources for the models that I presented in more detail and the studies that came out. And then in this slide, you have all the traditional non-integrated power systems models that I introduced in case you want to check any one of them out. And this is my contact information. I'm happy to field any questions or follow up after with you. And thanks so much.
Hey, JP, thanks so much. We do have some questions from the audience. First, is the GAPS model publicly available?
The GAPS model is currently, it is publicly available. It is an open source code. It does require proprietary solvers, as in general. So the model itself is available and you can access it, but the solver, you need to acquire a solver or adapt the model to run with a free solver. So the code is available, but you can't really run it readily unless you have that sort of infrastructure.
Okay, here's another one. What type, amount, and granularity of data are most needed to improve the accuracy of the models that you've talked about?
That's a good question. I think in terms of distribution representation, there is a need to track much more data at the feeder level to be able to represent, to sort of identify those representative feeders. For example, it is rare and hard to obtain 8760 by feeder. We for the analysis in Indiana, when we run this representative feeder, we only had the peak demand as a way of telling us how much capacity the feeder had, but that doesn't tell us really what's going on inside the feeder, especially in the secondary systems. So there is definitely better data that could be obtained to describe the hosting capacity of different parts of the feeder, and even maybe splitting feeders, complete feeders in subsections that could be more representative of the actual situations. As you go up transmission and generation, that data tends to be pretty available. In some cases, it's more a matter of it being sensitive, or in some cases, critical infrastructure. So it's not publicly available, but it can be, it's tracked by utilities or by ISOs and RDOs and available as well.
Thanks, JP. Tom,